So good morning.
Good morning.
It is fantastic to see all of your beautiful faces here this morning. Do you love my dress?
I love your dress.
I know, right? So this dress actually came from my Ghanaian family, and so it's hand-woven. They use these beautiful looms, cotton thread, and each and every individual thread is woven together in this beautiful tapestry. And so it was gifted to me by a beautiful man named Peter, and he takes care of us while we're there. He drives us. And Peter comes from nothing, no thing, no education, but he has a beautiful presence. And so the day that he came to give me my dress, it took me out at my knees because I know the depth of what it meant for him that he could give this white woman from Canada a bulga dress. And so I love it. I wear it all the time. It makes me very happy. So as many of you know, I've just returned from 6 weeks in Ghana, which is in West Africa, and we spend our time up in the northern part of Ghana. It's sub-Saharan Africa. We focus our time there in the north because that's actually the area of Ghana that's the most underserved. They face a lot of challenges up there in the north. Most of our time is, we spend most of our time in rural and remote communities. We do health screening, we do sexual and reproductive teaching in schools, we work in community health clinics, we teach in, teach nursing students. What else do we do? Community development projects. So we work in communities developing what it is they've identified that they would like to work on. It's interesting, when I come home, there's always a curiosity. So questions about the trip, questions about what was it like, you know, people wanting to really understand what it is. And I always struggle with that piece because it's difficult to describe. It's more of a felt sense than anything. And the best way, I guess, to put language to it is that it's a paradox. It's very, very, very hard work. It's both rewarding and challenging. We see beauty and we see immense pieces that are very ugly. We witness suffering, we witness healing, we teach, and we learn. But the piece that consistently threads through all of our experiences is a sense of kinship, of family and of community. So it's a felt sense. It goes back to that piece I was just saying. It's really a felt sense. And the best way I can label that felt sense is Ubuntu. So Ubuntu, loosely translated, means I am as we are as I am. So Ubuntu is a very complex word. It comes from the Nguni language, and it can be traced back actually to South Africa. There are related words in many of the sub-Saharan African cultures and languages. All of them have slightly different meanings. All of them are difficult to translate into English. We don't actually have a word for it in our English language. But despite this, the word Ubuntu is now widely known and used outside of Africa. I'm sure you've all seen the Facebook memes, all of those pieces, yes. We here in the Western world, we would call Ubuntu a humanist philosophy, which is probably the right term for it. But I know if I ever shared that with my Ghanaian family, they would laugh and laugh, and they would say, oh, madam, Ubuntu just is. Why do you need to define it? That's what they would say, I'm telling you. And I'd say, okay, fair enough. At the heart of each of those definitions, regardless of what language is being spoken, is the connectedness that exists between people. Ubuntu is the essence of being human. So it's something akin to a soul force. It's this deep cellular force. It's a metaphysical connection that's shared between people, and it helps us connect to each other. Ubuntu is kindness, compassion, and generosity. We are open and available to others. We are affirming of others, and we are not threatened when others are able and good. Ubuntu is caring and sharing and being in harmony with all of creation. It comes from a deep knowing that we all belong to a greater whole. It speaks to the fact that we cannot exist as human beings in isolation. You see, as human beings, we're actually hardwired to connect. It's a piece of what actually makes us human. It's written right into the code of our DNA. We yearn for a sense of belonging, a sense of community. We're able to express what it means to be fully human. We've survived as a species because we yearn to connect. It keeps us safe, it gives us security, and it gives our lives meaning and purpose. So I've given you the piece of a quote, but I want to share the rest of it. So this is from Archbishop Desmond Tutu. Africans have a thing called Ubuntu. It's about the essence of being human. It's part of the gift that Africa will give the world. It embraces hospitality, caring about others, being willing to go the extra mile for the sake of another. We believe that a person is a person through other persons, that my humanity is caught up, bound up with yours. When I dehumanize you, I dehumanize myself. The solitary human being is a contradiction in terms. Therefore, you seek to work for the common good because your humanity comes into its own in community, in belonging. And so I shared we spend 6 weeks in Ghana. We fly into Accra, it's right down on the coast, it's the capital city, and then we work our way up north. So I don't know if you know this, but Ghana actually has the fastest growing economy in Africa. They're doing well. And that in itself is an interesting statement. The southern part of Ghana is doing well, and up north, they still face immense challenges. Accra is a huge metropolis. It's teeming with people and industry. There's wealthy neighborhoods. There's also slums, but everything's got everything there that you can imagine. And when you're looking around Accra, when we spend those couple of days there, you can see all of the signs of new wealth and of prosperity. There's new homes, there's new vehicles, new businesses. They have a big, beautiful, shiny mall that our first day there, we go in to get a few things that we need to for our trip up north. It's like walking into Orchard Park, to be honest. So Accra is actually the closest we get to anything that looks like home. You could actually see parts and pieces of home there. But there's an interesting thing that happens there. We feel completely disconnected. We struggle to find our place, to find where we belong in this teeming metropolis. And so everyone's in a hurry. Everyone's in a hurry. They're tied to their phones, so they're driving and talking, they're driving and texting, they're walking and talking, they're tied to their phones is the best way to put it. So that's very familiar. Does it sound familiar? Yes, absolutely. And then a beautiful thing happens. We start to make our way north. As we work our way north, the experience changes. The spirit of Ubuntu grows stronger as we get further and further away from the urban centers, spend more time in smaller communities, smaller cities, smaller towns, and then the little tiny villages. The people live and work in their village. For the most part, they are peasant farmers and petty traders, and their life is hard. It's very hard. But there's a kindness that's there. There's a curiosity, an interest in connection. These communities look nothing like home here, nothing. There's less and less wealth, or what we would call wealth. Yet the further north we travel, the deeper our sense of belonging becomes. And so you can feel it. Again, like I said, it's a felt sense. You can feel the shift. And that shift is Ubuntu. There's the most beautiful ritual of greeting in Ghana. It makes me just, it fills my heart every time I get back on the land there. So you cannot start any conversation without first connecting, any conversation. So it doesn't matter if you're calling the taxi driver that you've never spoken to before. It doesn't matter if you're walking into the grocery store, the supermarket, whatever you might be doing. Everything starts first with connection. Good morning. How are you? How was your night? And so there's at least 47 languages in Ghana. Every language has their own sort of ritual and words for this greeting. The other piece that's interesting is that the further north we get, the more complex the greeting. So when we greet the chief in Naibok, he's called the Tindana, their Tindana. So that's one of the villages we spend a lot of time in. The greeting itself takes about 20 minutes. I'm not kidding. I'm dead serious. 20 minutes. 20 minutes of connecting before any business is even spoken. You see, the Tindana is their spiritual leader, and he is deeply, deeply connected to the land, connected to the ancestors, the people and the animal. He stewards their lands and resources. So before we start any work in the village, and this is the same in any place we go, we first visit the Tindana and ask his blessing to do our work. And so not one piece of business is started until everyone present has been greeted, acknowledged, and welcomed into the community. So I think I shared with you it gets more complex the further north we go. So it kind of goes like this. Good morning. How are you? How was your night? How's your family? How's your mother? How's your father? How's your sister? How's your brother? How's your dog? How's your goat? How's your donkey? How's the crops? How's the hunting? How's it just, it's a never-ending, beautiful expression of all of the threads that are woven together. I wish I could describe the feeling of that. Sitting in the presence of that where you are seen and fully seen and acknowledged for all of the parts and pieces that make you who you are. It is so beautiful. And thank God for that sense of belonging. You see, people assume we go to Ghana to save them, right? We've got these white nurses with all of this education, and we're going to go in and save all of these poor people living in the villages. But I'm here to tell you that's not what it is. We go to Ghana to experience what it means to be fully human. And in the process, we are actually the ones who are saved. You see, we are laid bare in Ghana, and so pushed to the very limits of our mental, emotional, and spiritual selves, to the very brink, the very edge of it. And then from that place, we're pushed again, the very limit of our physical selves. We're working in anywhere from 43 to 45 degrees Celsius. There's smoke, there's sand, there's dust. The physical environment is incredibly extreme. And so we are pushed so far, that think of that elastic band just being pulled so far that it's difficult to even string together a coherent thought sometimes. You can feel like it feels like there's a delay, like information is coming into you, and it actually takes a little bit of time to process because you are well, stripped bare is the best way to describe it. And so from that place, on our knees, like just on our knees, feeling incredibly naked, vulnerable, and uncertain, we question our very existence. We're bearing witness to the depths of human suffering. We are confronted face first with the flaws of humanity. And the questions start to bubble up. How can this be happening? How can this child die at home? They would be treated and sent home within hours. How can this mother die through childbirth? How does this child die from a fall that could be treated routinely at home? Those questions that confront us in so many moments through every day. How can this still be happening? Questions come up. What's wrong with us in the Western world? How can we completely ignore an entire continent? How is this still happening? How is this still happening? And why do we not care? Why do we not care? How can we let this continue? These are deep, soul-searching, existential questions. Questions that examine who we are as human beings, and then question the humanity of our world. And so from that place, right, from that place, like I said, laid bare, where the feeling of the immense suffering is impossible to even stay there. From that place, we just breathe, right? So we breathe. And we feel the connection. And that connection is Ubuntu. It's our connection to each other and to the people. It's our experience of shared suffering. And our Ghanaian family, when we're down there on our knees, they kindly, gently, and patiently, they pick us back up. They care for us. They breathe life back into us and show us what it means to be seen through the eyes of a common humanity. They recognize our suffering because it's a mirror of their own. You see, they're never alone. We're never alone. There's a thread that binds them to one another. It's woven into this beautiful tapestry. Their suffering is reflected in and shared with others. And through this, the weight of that suffering is lifted. And so they love, and that love is shared, and the weight is lifted. And they're joyful with the rains, the abundance of the harvest, and that harvest is shared. And they dance. Oh my, do they dance. And so yes, life is hard. It's very hard. But they love and they belong. And through this belonging, they share a common humanity. This is Ubuntu. We become one. I am as we are. We are as I am. So I want to share a story of a remarkable woman. I think I've known her for about 18 years now. Our School of Nursing has been doing work in Northern Ghana for almost 20. So Dr. Vida Yukong, it's her beautiful face is up there. Dr. Vida is the living, breathing, moving embodiment of Ubuntu. She was the youngest daughter of the first wife of a family in a tiny little village called Naibok. Her people are peasant farmers. Her mother made shea butter from the shea trees in the village, and what she didn't use for her family, she sold at the market. So when Vida was born, there was a policy in Ghana that each family had to send at least one child to school. Her father had already met this requirement by sending her oldest sister, Philomena. So Vida was actually destined to work in the village, work on the land, harvest shea butter like her mother, marry early, have lots of kids, and continue in the trade of her mother. But Philomena pleaded with their father, pleaded to have Vida go to school, and he agreed only if it didn't affect her household duties. So Philomena, I think she was 12 years old at the time, carried the 5-year-old Vida on her back 10 kilometers to school and 10 kilometers home. Philomena went on to get her midwifery training, and then she paid, using her income from that, she paid for Vida to attend junior high school. Once junior high was complete, Vida continued into senior high. So there wasn't a school, never mind within walking distance, there just wasn't a senior high school, period. So there wasn't one around, so she taught herself. I'm not kidding you, she taught herself. So now remember, there's no running water, no electricity, no laptops, no online class, no group chats, no English speakers in the village. She studied on her own, and she challenged the exams, and she finished at the top of her class. Yeah, I know. So she found her way into nursing training and then again graduated top of her class. She was admitted into the Rural Nurse Practitioner Program. Our faculty were there teaching in Ghana, teaching that program. That was some of our early work there. And they could see she was incredibly bright. So they put together funds for her to come to Kelowna to get her Bachelor of Science in Nursing. She continued on to complete her Master's of Science in Nursing. Vida was our first MSN student out of the School of Nursing. She was our first graduate. From there, she went on and did her PhD. So this beautiful, bright woman, from a tiny village in northern Ghana received a PhD from one of the top 25 universities in the world. Yeah. In between, and so the funny thing, in between all of these degrees, so between her BSN, MSN, PhD, she would go home, and she would go home and work as a nurse practitioner in her village up there in northern Ghana, and she would do everything she could to improve the health of the people. In her graduate studies, Vida developed Project Grow. So it's a community development model. Some of you may have heard of Project Grow. I know a lot of you are involved with some of the work that we do. So it's a community development model that focuses on empowering women. And so Vida could see that the lack of economic opportunity was negatively impacting the health of the women and therefore their families. So Project Grow is really simple. Provide the resources to the women and the communities will flourish. It's really that simple. So she started the first year, there was a few women in the village of Nyboc. I think there was five or six. Now, 10 years later, they have over 600 women registered. It's expanded beyond Vida's little village, and it's shifting the experience of life in so many of the villages there. So they're thriving, and they thrive because they're connected. It's the women who decide how the resources are allocated, and they always do it for the common good. Ubuntu. You see, this work, Project Grow, is the full expression of Dr. Vida being human, seeking the common good, and through that seeking, reaffirming her belonging. She's asked often why she doesn't just come to Canada and teach and do research. She would have a really good job here, make a really good income, life would be comfortable. I don't know how many times I've heard people ask, and so this is just the times that I've heard it, Vida, why don't you just come to Canada? And she's always puzzled. You can see this look kind of comes on her face, and she's puzzled. And so it's an interesting thing to watch. She's puzzled by the question. You see, these are her people. Ghana's her home. Those are her roots. That's where she gets her sense of belonging. That's where she experiences Ubuntu. Her humanity comes into its own in community and in belonging. So you see, Vida could be anywhere in the world right now, doing work anywhere. Where she experiences her full expression of herself is in her community. So it's one woman, a living, breathing example of Ubuntu. I am because we are. We are because I am. So this center, these PR people here, has been a tremendous support to Project Grow. I don't know if you know this, but last, it was around Christmas time last year, this center raised about $1,300. We sell shea butter. The shea butter we actually sold came from Vida's village, and it was made by her sister that still lives in the village. So we sold the shea butter, and it actually helped cover the cost for the roof on the nursing accommodations for the health clinic. So that's the nursing accommodations. They had started working on the roof just when I left this year. So that money that you guys so graciously donated went to that. Our Sandy is here. You see this cute little guy? Sandy, our beautiful Sandy, bought a goat named Simon. They use the goats as a form of currency. They donate the first female baby back to the women of Project Grow, and then they sell the further offspring to pay for any expenses that might come up. So that could be school fees, it could be health insurance, it could be an emergency medical visit. Maybe they need some repairs to their home. The goats become a form of currency, and so it gives them a sense of stability. And then there's Mike. Yes, Corrine's family gifted her with a donkey they named Mike in honor of her brother, and he's working and serving right now in the village of Pulongu. And so Mike, beautiful Mike, Corrine's brother, was a hardworking, patient, and gentle, and kind man. And now he has a beautiful donkey doing that same work in Ghana. And so, of course, we can't forget about my beautiful Bobby. He's got his Ghana shirt on today, too. He looks like $1 million. Looking good back there, Bobby. So Bobby has a donkey, which we named Bob, of course. Very original. He lives close to my parents' donkeys, Phil and Ed. So my mom's name is Phyllis, my dad's Edward. That's quite funny. So the donkeys they actually use to ease the burden of labor for the women. So they pull carts and they bring crops in back and forth from the field. They take goods to the market. They carry water. They plow the fields. Sometimes they're used as an ambulance. But what I know is that these donkeys, they ease the burden on the women there, and they also create economic opportunity. So every year when I return to the village, the villagers take me to see the donkeys. They're always so excited. You know, come. We share greetings, which can, of course, take anywhere from 5 to 20 minutes. And they usually give me a live chicken or two, which is interesting. I hate chickens. And but that's I'll share that story in a different talk one time. But they express gratitude for the pieces that connect us, so that connect them through me to my family at home, which now becomes their family in Ghana. It's beautiful, the threads that are woven together. And they remind me, I am because we are, and we are because I am. So last year, a very, very talented photojournalist came and joined us. And so she did videotapes, she took pictures, she put together a whole sort of media presentation on Project Grow. I want to just extend an invitation. Katie's doing an art installation that captures the essence of Project Grow, and of course through that, the essence of Ubuntu. If you'd like to see this work and learn a little bit more about Project Grow, just consider this your personal invitation. It's June 11th, 6:30 at the Innovation Center. So, Ubuntu, actually, is about unity. The whole and all of the individualized parts. The beautiful tapestry created when the individual threads are woven together. Now, does that sound familiar? Do we hear that here? Yes, right? It's one of the core principles that tie us together through our science of mind teaching. What our founder, Dr. Ernest Holmes, would say is that it's a sense or an idea of unity. So what Dr. Holmes does say, he's the founder of our teaching. He says that unity signifies the union of parts, a result of the many drawn together into one perfect harmonious whole. African scholar Michael Onibuche Eze says, if we belong to each other, we participate in our creations. We are because you are, and since you are, definitely I am. So you see, that's Ubuntu. So in closing, I want to share that the spirit of Ubuntu is actually alive and well. And so it's alive and well right here in this community. I can't recall the number of times people have told me walking into the center here that it just felt like they were coming home. It felt like coming home. I felt like I belonged. And when I hear this, I smile, because what is that? It's the spirit of Ubuntu. So if you're willing, I think I shared with you, Ubuntu is a felt sense. We don't have a word to describe it in English. It's a felt sense. So if you feel comfortable, I just want you to close your eyes. Just close your eyes. And just take a nice breath. And if it feels comfortable, you can just put your hand up on your heart. And then drop your attention down into your heart and imagine breathing in and out of that heart. And now with each breath, I want you to feel a sense of connection, a connection to those of us right here in this room. Just feel the threads that are woven together right here in this community. Feel that connection, that sense of belonging, a deep sense of security and safety, of being home. And now bathe yourself in this feeling. Just feel it permeating through every cell. It's filling you, spilling out from you. And just rest here and feel it. This is Ubuntu. And this is our natural state. This is where we are whole. And this is my gift to you. And so it is.